So, now to introduce the upcoming two speakers that we're going to be delighted to hear. We have Rita Kakati Shah. She is a gender diversity, inclusion, and career strategist, a speaker, author, and advisor. She is founder and CEO of UMA, empowering confidence, success, and resilience in youth, women, and minorities from underprivileged backgrounds. Rita began her professional career in finance at Goldman Sachs in London, where she was awarded the prestigious Excellence in Citizenship and Diversity Award. She is also a distinguished alumna of King's College London and serves on the advisory council of King's Business School, in addition to many other boards around the world. She is an associate at Democracy Without Borders and a regular participant in conversations around making the UN more current and inclusive. Following Rita's presentation, we will have Andreas Bummel speak. Andreas is a globally recognized advocate for democracy and world federalism. As the co-founder and director of Democracy Without Borders, Andreas has spearheaded initiatives aimed at enhancing democratic participation and governance on a global scale. His work focuses on the promotion of a United Nations Parliamentary Assembly, a concept aimed at bringing a more democratic, transparent, and representative structure to global decision-making processes. Bummel's contributions to the field of world federalism have been instrumental in advancing the dialogue around global democracy, earning him respect and recognition among policymakers, activists, and scholars worldwide. His passion for creating a more equitable and democratic global order makes him a pivotal figure at the World Federalist Conference, where he shares insights drawn from years of advocacy, research, and collaboration across borders.
So welcome to the presentation on United Nations Parliamentary Assembly. So we wanted to start off with some real-world scenarios to just really paint the picture. Think of the world we live in, where there are global problems all around us, and global problems need global solutions. Let's just take a look at an example. Something that we are all aware of, as an example, is planetary crisis requires urgent and bold international changes. A report, as an example, that was recently published on our Democracy Without Borders website, just about climate change and the fires that are happening. So this is just an example of too little, too late doesn't seem to quite work. And this is something that we all need to think about. Little headlines there that we see in the news and the world around us. So this is just something to really, really sort of bring in the message that this is a truly a world, a global problem that we encounter all around us. So let's think about planetary boundaries and the equivalence of how this is supposed to have bearing on humanity. So we're probably all aware of this diagram here on the left of the planetary boundaries and where it was coming to bear. Compare that to now, where we stand. As you can see, everything pretty much has gone spiraled outside of these boundaries to really, really kind of depict the issue of what we are facing on our planet in the world around us. So this is something that, humanity, all of us in general, have to think about and tackle together. Look where we are. So when we think of a UNPA, and we're going to come on to the detail of exactly what it is and how we can help, these are some of the literature and some of the media articles that are out there about UNPA and how it can actually help in terms of tackling such global crises and topics that are out there. Highlighted here is this middle paragraph. You can obviously take a look through everything. But it's been said now several times that novel arrangements such as a UNPA might be needed actually to make these governments more democratic and more relevant to really kind of tackle these crises on a planetary scale. Some more literature out there of where the campaign for the UNPA has actually been quoted and seen. And you can have a look at this as well. The creation of a UNPA would give elected citizens representatives actually a view and a say in what happens in the world around us. A parliamentary umbrella of multilateral collaboration would help overcome the current fragmentation that we see. third paragraph there, the UNPA could be strengthened over time, ultimately to become a world parliamentary body. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that as well. So let's look at where we are now within the UN and in a way, what the difference is of why the UNPA would actually help. So think about where we are with the United Nations, and something we're probably all familiar with now is that we're really there to serve member states. So let's take our example of climate change that we just shared and the planetary boundaries example. So we've known for a few decades now that, as an example, carbon emissions need to be reduced. But why has nothing really happened about that? Well, think about it. You know, the UN seeks to get consensus amongst pretty much all of the competing member states. They have their own agendas, different viewpoints, and you need consensus. It takes forever. So compare that to a UNPA, which would serve all of us global citizens, giving a voice to citizen elected representatives. And that's the key difference there. So think about the world and a place where all of us, you know, you can see this little analogy here in the picture, where all of us are together working towards the same goal to make decisions in the best interest of all people. So example here, living sustainably is in the collective best interest of all of us in humanity, even if not in particular for one particular nation. So now let's look at the goals and purposes of having the United Nations Parliamentary Assembly. We just talked a little bit about this. It would create a connection between us as citizens and the planet that we all live on and share. You can actually practice true global citizenship. An interesting analogy here is that spend a lot of time with young people and students. And these days, when you ask students, you know, where do you come from? Where do you kind of associate with? A lot of people don't just state one town or one country or one place. They actually have travels, they have been to, they have researched, they care about different countries. And a lot these days, people actually identify as global citizens. Because of that, this is a way to really practice what we all nowadays starting to preach, and certainly the next generation coming up. So having a UNPA would also create conditions for UN Charter review, something that we've been talking a little bit about now for quite a while. It would also facilitate the formation of global political parties rather than just country specific. It support democratization, a key aspect of why do we need a UNPA. It would also strengthen legitimacy and the accountability of the UN. Who measures what happens right now? Who's accountable and to whom? This is something that we can all actually address on a daily basis. You can actually pressure your own government to actually act and deliver on promises that they've made. You can drive a global constitutional process. So this is something we're talking about towards that world parliament idea, and transformation into ultimately what is becoming what we're talking about, a world parliament for all citizens to be equally part of. So when we talk about a UNPA, a question that often comes up is you have plenary discussions and you have committee meetings. And really, what are the difference in what takes part in these meetings? What's important about that? What really stands out? So really, really high level, when you think of a plenary, an opening plenary, a closing of a conference such as today, it's where you make very outline overarching statements to really summarize a topic. So this is where we said major statements are made. And they're usually quite broad ranging, usually a topic, broad ranging topic, and these can take place at these plenaries. And this is where the conference, general full overall conference decisions can be made. Committee meetings, on the other hand, these go into the more of the nitty gritty. This goes into the detailed. You go into negotiation, deliberating resolutions that will ultimately get made. This is where the draft resolutions can be spoken about, deliberated and debated to be made. So this is a bit of a very high level overview when you're going to be hearing terms, especially those of you taking part in the model UNPA coming up soon. These are terms you're going to be quite familiar with by the end of it. So now let's look about the pillars. When we talk about the UNPA and this global legal order that we talk about, what do we actually mean? Let's look about these four main pillars. So you would ultimately get universal legislation. So this would be a bicameral democratic world parliament. This is a really, really crux point here to think about. It's not just one viewpoint, but you can actually have different viewpoints, different parties, different democratic viewpoints brought across. You could have worldwide arms control. What does this mean? Well, the elimination of the means of warfare, you know, weapons of mass destruction, anything conventional like that would actually come within this pillar and bucket that you could look at. Settlement of disputes in court, where you could have mandatory international jurisdiction. And then the fourth pillar, how could you enforce this? Well, there would be means of enforcing it, courts, peace force, local police that would ultimately work towards this ultimate goal for this. What about key features of the UNPA, which would ultimately, talking about evolving into this idea of a world parliament? So the key is that all of these assets and these facets that we've been talking about would be complementary processes. They would work side by side, step by step. I love using the phrase that I love using the phrase that this is something that you have to crawl before you can walk, before you can run. And this is exactly what the process here would be. You start off small, you start off step by step. You would have an indirect to direct elections taking place. And in principle, this would be open to the current UN member state and then more. So it goes from the philosophy of having a digressive now to having a direct proportional representation. And we'll look at a couple of slides coming up more about that. This would be more consultative functions from there going to the co-legislative powers. Initially, there would be no UN charters changes needed. So that would be something, again, a small step. There's no rash decisions or anything, rash processes taking place here. But ultimately, it's going to be including, you know, we think of making the UNPA, the UN, ultimately more inclusive, more current, more listening to the voices of everyone out there. The purpose is to make this more inclusion of the opposition and minorities, so everybody's voices are heard. And then you'd have committees that would actually be looking and tackling the different issues that affect us all around the world. So possible rights and then functions of a UNPA. So this would fall below the threshold of the UN Charter change. Adoption of political resolutions. So this is something that would be really, really helpful in the process. But you'd also have the right to question UN officials. Now, that is a key point, whereas historically, as we know, this is something that you don't often get across. This gives you the right to question and hold accountable, as we've already talked about. There would be reading and the co-decision making of UNGA resolutions and participation in UN negotiations as well. So there would be the establishment of inquiry committees, a co-decision at election of top UN officials, as well as a co-decision for the adoption of the UN budget as well. So these are all points to kind of think of how us as civil society can get involved, how the decisions taken part and made in this as well, and have a voice, and also have the right ultimately to submit questions to the ICJ, the International Court of Justice. So this is something that we would all actually have a say in, a part in, have equal ownership in, so to speak. So what are the possible stages of this global constitution that we talk about, and ultimately the formation of this world parliament? As we mentioned, it's initially baby steps, you know, it's a step-by-step process, an incremental process. Initially coming from national parliaments, and then they would be directly elected. You could have some sort of a consultative body to start with. It could start with a small knit group to start with UNP rights and powers expanding over time as you get to trial and test how things work, eventually becoming a real world parliament. So here is just some mock timelines to just give you an idea of how this could potentially work in practice. So think of 2030, establishing just a high-level United Nations Parliamentary Assembly, establishing it then. 2040, the UN Charter process, a review process can be launched. And then 2045, you could have a global referendum on the global constitution that we've just spoken about. This could be free and fair direct elections for a world parliament. So, step-by-step process, no running before we can walk in. This is something that everyone could have a say in over time of how this would work. Now, let's look a little bit how things are currently done, and also really to hone in why we need to do something about this. So, if you think of citizen representation at the UN General Assembly, and as an example, let's take the 128 least populous countries. So, here we can see the least populous countries are marked in the dark blue, with the other countries being in the gray. So, the least populous countries get the majority of votes. Two-thirds of the votes goes to the ones that don't even have that many people by population. What is going on there? So that's the first question that this raises in the first place. Look at this slide here. Take of that same process, but now look at what does that mean for citizen representation at the UN General Assembly. Now let's look at the 10 most populous countries. Look at the 10 most populous countries, this time in the blue, with the other 183 countries in the gray. And you can see the key there of some of the examples of the countries that we mentioned as the populous countries. Only 5.2% of the vote goes to the 10 most populous countries. So that in itself gives you an example of how there isn't necessarily the most fairest sharing of decision making, of issues, of things that happen at the moment. So these are part of the issues that we are trying to address and overcome with the formation. So how are we doing this? Well, we are part of, a campaign, a global campaign for having a UNPA. You're all welcome to take a look. Our website is given there, unpacampaign.org, endorse. These are some of the examples of organizations, civil society organizations that have already endorsed. Here it says individuals, organizations from 150 countries, and over 1,600 current and former MPs have endorsed this already. That figure's actually gone up now, but it gives you an example of how this is growing. It's grown. This is something that is the future, and it's just a matter of working towards this goal together. So on that, I wanted to thank you for listening to this presentation. I'm now going to pass on to my colleague, Andreas Bummel, who will continue the presentation. And then we're happy to take any questions that you may have. Thank you.
There you are, Andres.
Okay, thank you very much. So excellent to be with you, and thank you, Rita, for this wonderful presentation. I would like to first commend Alex, Erica, and everybody else who's been involved in organizing this conference for doing this. It's wonderful, and especially that tomorrow some of you will be participating in the model simulation on the UN Parliamentary Assembly Committee. Not the plenary, we heard about that already just now. So there are a number of challenges that have to be addressed and overcome as we move towards establishing a UN Parliamentary Assembly. And I will not delve much into it, but I was asked if I can perhaps address the question of popular support, and that's what I'm going to do. Oftentimes, there is this idea, a myth perhaps, that there is popular disagreement with the idea of creating a Parliamentary Assembly at the UN and radically transforming the UN. And if we are to believe surveys, international surveys that have come up over time, this is not true. And I would like to show you the results of a 15-country survey that was carried out last year. And for this purpose, I will share also the screen. So what I'm talking about is the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung's Global Census, which they carry out annually since I think five years ago, and it's a 50-country survey, which last year included the ones that you can see on screen from different world regions, Argentina, Brazil, France, Germany, India, Indonesia, Japan, Kenya, Poland, South Africa, South Korea, Tunisia, Turkey, United Kingdom and the United States. So it's roughly representative, I would say. And the interesting thing this year was that, or last year, sorry, was that last time was that they included in the survey a question about support of a world parliament. And what is interesting here is that they were asking this question, which is now on screen. They were asking respondents whether they actually endorse a world parliament where the seats are allocated according to population size, and that can take binding legislative decisions. So we heard already that we can look at the UN Parliamentary Assembly project as a process that starts modestly and moves towards the vision of a world parliament. So this question is not addressing the idea of a consultative body like we are promoting it at this time, which is really pragmatic, but the situation further down the road, perhaps, where we have a global legislative system with the world parliament at the center. And the results, they are quite amazing. And that's also why we wanted to show them to you today. So you can see them here on screen now. You can see that there is major support of the idea of a legislative world parliament, especially in the global south. You can see on the screen, like in Kenya, which is the country to the left, which has recorded the most support from respondents, where 81% overall either said they strongly support or somewhat support the idea of a legislative world parliament, whereas only 17% either said they strongly oppose or somewhat oppose. This is quite amazing. And in India, we have similarly big numbers, like 78 leaning towards support, 78% leaning towards support, and 10% only leaning towards disagreement. And in South Africa too, we have 73% leaning towards support, and 21 only are negative. So in all these 15 countries, except two, a strong majority actually was leaning towards support, which I find quite remarkable. And countries in the global south are those where support was recorded the strongest. We have two countries, interestingly, that are at the lower end of the spectrum in this particular survey, which is the United Kingdom and the United States. This is not necessarily a surprise, given that the UK and the USA over time and historically and still to a degree have been dominating the international scene. And I would speculate, we can discuss this, that the skepticism comes from the fact that they believe they would be outvoted in many questions in a world parliament, although, as has been pointed out in the previous presentation, we would be dealing with a parliament of elected individuals. So UK, USA, India, etc. wouldn't actually be present in a world parliament as we understand it, because what we would be dealing with would be a body of elected individuals who would form transnational groups based on common ideologies and worldviews. So if we look at the global per country average, we can see that we have here 60% actually leaning towards support, and just 21 are against this. So of course, if we imagine global elections to a world parliament, we face one key obstacle, which is, in my opinion, really the key single and most important obstacle towards developing global democracy and world federalism in particular, and that is the state of affairs in terms of national democracy. I think global democratization in the sense of making the UN more democratic and democratization at the nation state level, they are intertwined, they are linked together. And just these days, I think it was yesterday, The Economist published their annual assessment of the state of global democracy, and that's the last slide I'm showing here, where you can see how it plays out globally. And there are today still 55 authoritarian regimes where you cannot actually have free, fair, and competitive elections. So in those countries you see marked red here, it is virtually impossible today to have actual elections for a global parliament. I mean, they don't even have proper elections at the nation state level. So this is a huge problem. However, we do argue all the time that it is still possible to establish a parliamentary assembly that has a consultative function. And even in countries that are rated hybrid regimes or flawed democracies, even in some authoritarian regimes, there are proper opposition groups, even in the parliament. They are struggling, but they are there. And we think that is one of the functions that we have here for the UN Parliamentary Assembly, that it can help these groups to have a seat and a voice at the global scale. And this is one element why we think that a UN Parliamentary Assembly would assist global democratization. I will stop here and thank you very much. I wish you a wonderful conference today and tomorrow.
Thank you so much for that, Andreas. I'm going to move to the question period. So if you have any questions for our speakers, please put your questions in the chat. I do want to kick it off with one question. I think it's really motivational for all the people here to see that there's been such an elevation in the political will. What are some of the steps forward, seeing that more eyes are on this subject? There's greater awareness than ever before. It's the fight for a UNPA has been a long time coming, but what are some of the next steps to keep this political will increasing? Oh, I think I have to ask you folks to unmute again. Here we go.
Who would you like to go first? That's the question for us, I think.
Okay, well, why don't we start with Rita?
Yeah, sorry, can you just repeat that, Erica? Because I couldn't hear the first part. Yeah.
With all the increased political will and some of the slides Andreas has just shown us, what are some steps that the campaign for the UNPA and maybe broader actions in collaboration with civil society, what can be done to keep this momentum going and keep political will increasing?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. And I think in short, if we knew the actual answer to that and it was very, very straightforward, it would probably have been done by now. But I think what we can do is keep having discussions such as this, such as getting our voices, civil society's voices together, being that sort of, almost that sort of, megaphone for the voice and getting the UNPA and just keep repeating the message. Recently as well here in New York, you know, we had a meeting with the office of the PGA, president of the General Assembly, as a start of a potential collaboration to get voices to ultimately move towards the idea of a UNPA and making it a reality. So it's things like that. You just have to keep on at it. If you know somebody local that is in politics or a change maker or even a local mayor or somebody that has some sort of a say in something, get involved, have a conversation, tell them about what you're doing, see how you can help and get involved. That's it is, it's grassroots. I think one of the questions actually asked, like, is it just top down or can you do it bottom up? You absolutely have to do it bottom up. That's the way you get change happening. So I think that would be my way of suggesting it. Bottom up, grassroots, do everyone do their part.
Thank you for that response, Rita. Andreas, do you have anything you want to add?
Yes. I think we have very different levels, which is including the grassroots mobilization and raising the awareness, bringing together civil society, which we're doing. And I think civil society is increasingly proactively picking up the idea of a UN Parliamentary Assembly because it is increasingly being perceived as a key ingredient in making global governance more inclusive and democratic, which is necessary as one element in strengthening the UN too, because if we want to strengthen the UN, it has to become more legitimate as well. And that is the institutional key to achieve that. However, the thing is that like those surveys show, the key obstacle arguably is not that people don't want this, but that governments don't prioritize UN reform, and they don't realize how changing the UN and transforming global governance actually serves their own best interest. I think that is the key issue, and that governments, mostly, not all of them, but mostly, they are entrenched in parochial and national considerations only. And it is our task to actually bring together a group of credible governments that are willing to move this forward. And those surveys help, because like in Kenya and India, I think in democratic countries, we can come up with the argument that actually it is popular to do this, but most governments, they lack the courage to to test this.
Thank you for that, Andreas. I'm going to move to a question from our chat, and I paraphrase a little bit, but the gist of the question is, how do we maintain, what do we say to people who ask what happens to state sovereignty? How do we maintain a level of state sovereignty, but also integrate a global parliament into our world and, represent those issues? Maybe this time I'll start with Andreas and move to Rita.
Well, yes, the vision is a legislative world parliament, the question that was also asked in the survey. So indeed, there would be a limitation of sovereignty. But we would argue limitation of sovereignty is a negative way to look at it. Actually, countries that work together at the global scale, they share sovereignty and actually win sovereignty back. Arguably, the process of globalization, global interdependence, the poly crisis that is going on, it's undermining state capability. We can look at how, for instance, taxation has eroded in terms of corporations. So a system with a world parliament at the center would provide the legitimacy to deliberate on how these matters can be addressed. And in turn, if that is more effective, it actually helps countries, for instance, to stabilize their tax base, to eradicate tax loopholes in other jurisdictions, etc. So we argue that sovereignty is strengthened. It's not diminished, it is strengthened, but at a higher planetary level.
All right. Rina?
You have to let me, I can unmute now.
Okay. Yeah.
So I would 100% agree with that, but I would also like to maybe just turn the question on its head a little bit, to think of it this way. Each country, each state has its own different nuances, climate nuances, demographics, language, food, everything has its own personality. We know that. And at no point is someone trying to change this and make everything unified and exactly the same. What you're trying to do is look at the strengths, look at potential areas for development, but work with other solution providers to achieve those. An example being that if there is a country that you're visiting or a country that you're from and there is some sort of local infrastructure issue, why not speak to other counterparts in other countries that do things differently and swap and change ideas for the betterment ultimately of your own people, of your own countries? So what you're doing there is working together to strengthen yourselves. So as Andreas phrased it, this actually helps strengthen sovereignty by actually working together. So I think if you think of it that way and working together as global citizens rather than as competitors, as things like that, then it makes it a lot easier to work together and think of it that way.
I love that. It's a very brilliant response. I think that it speaks also to the impacts of climate change. Coastal cities are going to have different challenges than those in rural areas. So those challenges and solutions to those challenges can be explored collaboratively. So thank you, Shimal, for that question. I'm going to move on to another question from the chat from Arthur Dahl. How do you balance representation purely on a population basis with the need to represent human diversity in such, small island developing states? Rita, do you want to
take
it off?
So I think, one thing we said about when you have a UNPA and eventually a world parliament is that you take small steps, and this is step by step. One of the reasons for that is so you don't just sort of run with all the ideas and something just doesn't work. You try things, you trial it different ways, you try see what works, what doesn't stick. So for example, and this sort of actually segues a little bit from the last question, that each state, each country, each area will have its nuanced little goals and its own kind of priorities for working on and its own budget, I guess, where it is. So the whole point of this is to kind of work together to think, okay, this is what affects you, that's absolutely fine. This is something that might be a problem. If you are the one person that lives on that one island and you are the population of one, you care about that one issue. We understand that. But having said that, the rain, the climate, the wind around you, the quality of what's growing around you is something that matters. You may need help, you may need aid from other countries. So ultimately, you do need the support of others at some point. So only segueing yourself to only think of one area in the long run isn't going to help you, but thinking of other solutions, thinking of other areas, think getting involved in other conversations helps you as well. It's that almost like group, that community feel, building your tribe that works with you. So that's what I would say. Like I said, it's it takes time to kind of really see how this would work in practice. You know, if you remember that timetable we shared in the first set of slides, we said 2030 is just a very rough date of potentially when you could enact the UN pay for the first time, but that is only just a couple of step by step and with a small body to start with. So let's see how that works. And this is the whole point, it's a collaborative process. It's supposed to take feedback. It's supposed to have tweaks. That's how you change and that's how things work together.
Thank you for that. Andreas, do you have any comment?
Yeah, I mean, I would add an institutional perspective since we are here at the World Federalist Conference, which is to stress the bicameral design that we are striving for, which has been mentioned previously, meaning that the parliamentary body that would roughly be based on population size, although not directly at the beginning, would be making decisions together with a state chamber as today's General Assembly. So that is what we have in federations at the nation state level. You have an upper body, you know, an upper chamber and a lower chamber, a House of Representatives and a Senate. And those together, they have particular competences. And the point, of course, here now is that in this upper chamber, the General Assembly or Senate-like body, countries, irrespective of population size, still would have the possibility to bring in their views and perspectives. That is, I think, a key component of federalism. And what I also would like to add here is, I mean, it's true that in a global parliament, that is roughly, you know, where the seats are roughly allocated according to population size. Small countries might have a little, you know, a little number of seats only. But imagine, like I said before, though they are not as such represented in the parliament, but their delegates would group together with others with common perspectives and interests. So it would be a completely different dynamism than what we have today at the UN. And I just recalled when we started the campaign for UN Parliamentary Assembly, a representative from a small island state at the time told me, well, they rather have little say and voice in a system that works for the common interest than a big say in a system that is completely dysfunctional. So that's another perspective.
Thank you so much for that. I'm going to go to another question from the chat. This is from Leela Cotton. Welcome back. I remember you from last year. So what do you think of the possibility of countries bringing with them members of parliament to their delegation at the UNGA? Although it's rare, do you think developing this tradition could be seen as a first step in regard of having citizen representation at the UNGA in some way? Andreas, we'll kick it off with you.
Of course, that is excellent. I mean, there are innovative approaches, including, for instance, putting youth delegates on state delegations at the UN. That is wonderful and it's important. It is a way to break up this this idea that there is exclusive representation for executive branches of government at the UN. However, I mean, there are very grave limitations here, because usually these delegates, they, if it comes to actual voting and such, they simply have to adhere to what the capitals want them to do, right? And there's also, in particular with regard to members of parliament, in some cases, it's a tokenism, and you would find especially parliamentarians from the governing parties there. Opposition would not necessarily be included, especially not such people who ask, you know, difficult questions. So I think it's a good practice that should be extended and further used, but it does not replace this institutional step to have an actual body that has oversight capability, for instance, as a body.
Wonderful. Rita?
And just to add to that, really, so I think absolutely you need to hear the voices at each of these meetings and each of these committee meetings that take place from the different representations, whether it's sort of youth, whether it's other minority groups, whether it's sort of something of that sort, but also and something else that we actually work with some of the other civil societies, Democracy Without Borders, is having a civil society envoy potentially as a voice to the at the General Assembly. So this would be somebody that potentially could sit with the President or the General Assembly, or some sort of voice that would actually specifically, their task is to make sure they bring voices, viewpoints from civil society representatives, mm-hmm. that, and separately having a World Citizens Initiative, having that where people can actually voice their viewpoints ahead of time, so that it's actually an agenda item up for discussion and deliberation at these UNGA meetings that take place, and others. So those are just some things that are up our sleeves and other civil societies right now.
I love that. It's one thing to attend. It's another to have a seat at the table and discuss the issues at hand. Shimmel has another question. I think Andreas has actually mentioned something that kind of alludes to it. This may be our last question before we segue to a conclusion, depending on the response time, but how does establishing a global parliament, how can it resolve problems of poverty and social inequality? Rita, why don't we start with you for this one?
So I would say one thing we alluded to before is having the idea of like having a global think tank, another way of describing what we're just talking about. So in a way, different countries, every country in some way has its own version of social inequality, has its own version of poverty in its local state, borough, area of where it is. But, you know, some work better than others. So I think having a little bit of a think tank, what works, what doesn't, and changing the ideas can help. So having this idea of the global parliament, world parliament, having these ideas of folks working together can, again, only help with this. And it's not just a matter of having ideas, but, you know, how do you split the budget? How can you engage youth differently? How can you work in different areas that might be of a problem area in your particular area? So I think these are all ways you could work together. This is all part of the larger agenda of how social inequality, how problems of poverty could actually be long-term solved over time if folks work together.
Thank you so much for that, Rita. Andreas? I know you mentioned it a little bit, but please share your thoughts.
I think it's a good question, because, of course, the point about setting up a world parliament is not just to provide unrepresented groups, minorities, opposition, etc., a voice and a seat at the global table, but actually have a system that can take decisions quicker, more effective than today, and in the ideal case of a universal nature. So Democracy Without Borders, we are not prescriptive in saying what this system would do, but it would have to have proper competences, I think, in the important areas that would allow it, you know, to also implement decisions in an effective way. And addressing poverty and development is one of them. And in my opinion, in my personal opinion, a global parliament should have the power to tax, right, for taxation within defined boundaries, of course. But I think that a wealth tax or other taxes, a carbon tax, are instruments that can be used, the proceeds of which can be used to manage economic redistribution to address extreme poverty and inequality. So, but I mean, I don't know what the World Parliament specifically would do, right? For us, the point is that we need a system that can do this and that can have global deliberation.
Absolutely. Alex, let me know. Would you like me to close the Q&A? Are you ready to segue to conclusion? Or can I take one more question in the chat?
Maybe we would have time for one more question. I think that would be fine.
I think there's one question. It comes from Holly Weeks in the chat. Can a government by and for the people be established by lottery rather than elections? Andres, why don't we start with you?
Well, I think no.
Okay.
I don't think this is possible. I think that deliberative assemblies, they are a wonderful complement in a democratic design and toolbox. So I support deliberative assemblies in this sense, but elections and representative democracy cannot be replaced, in my opinion.
Rita?
Yeah, and I would agree with that. I think in theory, you could obviously try something like that, but it would just collapse on its face. I mean, you've seen historically, you've seen the research out there that if anything doesn't have some sort of a structure, some sort of democratic process involved, it doesn't actually work out. And the whole point of what we're doing with the UNPA is trying to get more democratic views across in the voting system. So I think having that, getting wider people in consideration for these positions is the way forward.
Thank you so much for your presentations.